romantic age. Now, this Victorian pity. Yeah, Victorian age is taken to cover from 1837 to 1901. 1837 is the year in which Queen Victoria succeeded to the throne of England, and 1901. In 1901, she died. So just like Elizabethan period, Victorian period was also quite popular for, refined culture, prosperity, peace, and great advancement in science. In the field of science and technology. Okay. So by Victorian era, Britain became the world's most, powerful nation. Okay. Now, but let me tell you, this age is popularly known as Age of Confusion. Age of Confusion. And this age also witnessed a great advancement in the fields of science and technology. And yeah, let's one second. Just a second. Yes, so during Victorian era, England become much more democratic compared to previous periods and previous centuries like Elizabethan and neoclassical and romantic era. Victorian England is much more democratic. And writers, most of the writers are realistic writers. They remain very close to nature. They portray how what they have seen in nature as it is. Okay, it is quite different from Romantic Age. Okay, Romantic Age and Victorian Age, there is a slight difference between Romantic Age and Victorian Age, because in Romantic Age they mixed it with their imagination. The poems and other works of Romantic era was the product of imagination. But during Victorian era, they remain, adhered to nature. That means realism. Okay. Now, more and more people started to read these works, because books became very cheap, and novel became the mainstream, main runner of the literature. Charles Dickens, Jane Austen, Oscar Wilde. So these are the few popular writers of Victorian age. And their works became very popular among middle class people, because Charles Dickens is a proletarian writer. See, so far till 18th century, writers, they only portrayed the life of noble class people, or life of upper class people. But writers of Victorian period, they started to write stories, plots about ordinary people or proletarian class or working class or ordinary people like us. Okay, so more and more people started to read. Hello, please mute your mic. Hello. Yeah. Okay. And characters are realistic. They resemble real life characters. Now, the chief characteristics of Elizabethan age, popular writers and poets, Lord Alfred Tennyson, Matthew Arnold, Gerard Manley Hopkins, D.G. Rossetti, Dante Gabriel Rossetti, etc. Other some of the popular poets. Then Oscar Wilde. Oscar Wilde, I think you're familiar with art for art's sake movement. Okay, so and his dramas were very popular. Then Lewis Carroll, John Ruskin, etc. are some of the few prose writers. Now, Victorian poetry. Let's see what makes Victorian poetry different from romantic poetry. Okay, so I told you poetry of romantic period were product. They were subjective in nature. They were subjective. I mean, products of pure imagination. Okay. So anyway, instead of making them subjective, I mean, last class we have discussed. I mean, yeah. Discuss Shelley Keats, and before that we have discussed about William Wordsworth. He's known as an egoist, egocentric poet, because they mostly, I mean, a romantic poet, they mostly wrote about the life that they have, I mean, seen around, or else about themselves, especially William Wordsworth. He's known as an egocentric poet because most of the poem, talk. I mean, poems he wrote talk about himself or about those persons whom he has direct contact with. But Victor, unlike romantic poets, Victorian poets, they copied. I mean, they copied life as it is, instead of mixing it with some kind of a higher type of imagination. They copied the nature as it is. Yeah, even they use a lot of classical and medieval myths, historical allusion, but still they had a trait of realism in their work. Then other popular form of poetry is dramatic monologue. I have already given you a brief introduction about dramatic monologue in the first class. Dramatic monologue is the abrupt starting. I mean, it's a form of poetry. Dramatic monologue is the form of poetry in which poetry will start like a dialogue. Such kind of poetry will have an abrupt starting, and obviously a speaker will be there, and passive listeners. There will be only one speaker and sometime one or more than one passive listeners. That is dramatic monologue. And the chief exponent of dramatic monologue is Robert Browning. Okay, Robert Browning is said to be the father of dramatic monologue. Now, just like romantic era, just like William Blake, we have discussed the poems of William Blake in the last class. So, I mean, we have seen that some kind of agitations in his poem against child labor or social events that prevailed during 18th century, isn't it? Similarly, Victorian period, I mean, in Victorian period also, we can see these writers questioned, they also agitated against child labor, rights of women, and science and religion. Okay. Now, another main feature is that actually these poems are heavily loaded with imagery, visual imagery. Yeah. If you read the poems of Alfred Tennyson, they have, I mean, all those poems have got a picturesque quality, cinematographic quality or picturesque quality. Now, obviously, I told you, Victorian period is a period of confusion and age of doubt. Okay, and lot of, I mean, the era produced lot of, I mean, Victorian writers produced lot of psychological works. Psychological, I mean, novels, poems. Yeah. Now, I told you why the people were in a state of confusion. Because, I mean, the evolutionary scientists like Charles Darwin, then other utilitarian philosophers like Herbert Spencer, John Stuart Mill, etc., joined their hands against religious institutions. So the very foundation of religion, religions, okay, was shaken. Okay. So people were utterly confused. They don't know what to believe in or what to reject, whether they should believe religion or they should follow the rules or the very theory of scientists. So that is why the period is said to be the age of utter confusion. Anyway, writers and thinkers like Alfred Tennyson and Matthew Arnold, they try to bring some kind of compromise between these powerful forces. That means, obviously, religion as well as science. These two are two powerful governing forces. Yeah. So Alfred Tennyson and Matthew Arnold, if you read their poem, you can see that they always try to bring some kind of compromise between these two forces. So they advised church people to be less rigid. See, less ri see more and more people. Actually, Victorian age also witnessed, even though it is unlike, let me see. But during Restoration era, people became very loosely moral, isn't it? They lost, yeah. They don't, I mean, they followed their ruler, Charles I and Charles II. They were libertines. Similarly, people, they were also they led a life without any principles. But in Victorian era, they upheld such kind of moral things. So the writers of Victorian period, they advise church people to be less rigid and more liberal. Okay, to be less rigid and more liberal. And they also requested, they appealed to scientists to be more generous and humanistic so as to maintain some kind of equilibrium between science and religion. Okay. Anyway, industry and other forms, and other fields, have witnessed a rapid growth during Victorian period. Okay, so this age is also known as age of decadence. One second. Now let's see the main difference between romantic poetry and Victorian poetry. So I told you romantic poetry is the product of medievalism, Hellenism, supernaturalism, and imagination. Whereas Victorian poetry, even though they still maintain the such features like myth, legends, they mostly stuck on to realistic issues, and they then struggle between science and religion. If you read the works of Victorian period, then you can see a conflict between science and religion. Now, romantic period, actually they admire, they worship. During romantic period, poets, they admire, they worship nature, they idealized it. But Victorian people, instead of idealizing, they copied nature. They have shown nature as it is to the readers. Okay, instead of idolizing, instead of worshipping, instead of getting a solution from the nature, actually, if you read the works of romantic poets, obviously they are often trying to get some kind of solution for their problems from the nature, isn't it? Prelude, William Wordsworth poetry, he takes nature as it as his guide or teacher or mentor, isn't it? Similarly, most of the romantic poet, they seek nature, for their for a solution to their problems. But Victorian poets are much more what practical than romantic poet. They copied nature. I mean, they have shown nature as it is to the reader. Now, yeah, as I told you, emotion, imagination, and spontaneity was pre were prevalent in their works during romantic, yeah, in the works of romantic writers. But Victorian poets, they gave importance to intellectualism and realism. So these are the common, the major differences between romantic poetry and Victorian poetry. Okay. Now, best we will deal with Robert Browning. So Robert Browning, as I told you, is the father of dramatic monologue. So an English poet, playwriter, and father of dramatic poetry. Okay. So about him, he was born in a religious family, so he's a religious poet. But let me tell you, his characters, his poetic characters are very eccentric. Even though he had led a well-disciplined life, yes, his mom is very religious. His father is very was very strict. But you can see all his characters are not that what who had followed the social norms. Okay, all his characters are eccentric, artist, sensual in nature. Now his famous works are Pauline and Paracelsus, and his work. Let me tell you, his wife's name is Elizabeth Barrett Browning. She was 12 years elder to him. See, his wife was pretty what popular poet. After the death of his wife, only Robert Browning became an acclaimed poet in England. Okay. Even though he was able to produce some popular poems like Pauline and Paracelsus at the beginning of his career, his reputation declined after compilation of Sordello. Actually, Robert Browning is notoriously famous for altering the history. Historiographic metafiction. I think you are familiar with historiographic metafiction. Similar, I mean, altering the history, or mixing history with that of fiction, like that. The same technique he has applied in poetry. So that is why I told you this. Robert Browning is quite popular, notoriously famous for altering history. Anyway, Sordello, that is according to critics, this is the most difficult poem ever written in English language. Okay. It is pretty difficult to decipher the deep meaning of the poetry. So critics says Robert Browning himself acknowledged that soon after the compilation of this poetry, he told that only God knows the real meaning of this poem. Okay, when he started the compilation, he had some control over it, but towards the end, he lost the control over his own poem, Sordello. Anyway, you don't have to study the entire text. Even though it is included in your poem, you have only book two to study. There are six parts, I mean six books in Sordello. You have only book two. Now, next one is yeah. So in his poem, you can see a kind of what. Journey, a spiritual journey. See, in a deeper, if you read it two or three times, you can see that all his characters resembled him, some way or other way resembled him. Even though he's not that, he's not a libertine, recluse, eccentric, but in some way or other way, you can see a trace of him in all his characters. Okay. And he tried to give a greater meaning to art and artist in all his poems. Yeah. Browning's famous work Pied Piper of Hamelin is still popular among kids. Now let's see what is dramatic monologue. I mean all the po all poems that have been included in block 8 are dramatic monologues. Now let's see what is dramatic monologue. So dramatic monologue is a type of poetry which has got a theatric quality. I told you I mean such type of poem will start abruptly, okay, with a sudden dialogue or some kind of question, just like media is starting from the middle. Okay, so speaker will be active and listeners all throughout the poem, they will not have listeners will not have a single dialogue. They will be passive, just like an I mean John Donne's poetry. canonization, valediction forbidding morning. In canonization, he talks to his friend. Please keep quiet. Then in valediction forbidding morning, he's advising his wife. Similarly, dramatic monologues are also like that. The speaker will be addressing some unknown listeners. Anyway, they will be passive all throughout the story. Poem. The best poem that you have is Porphyria's Lover. It's a very interesting poem. As I told you, Victorian period is also known as Age of Confusion. And most of the works were product of psychological conflicts or psychological issues. So this is a psychological poem, a psychological monologue. Okay, now let's see. Yeah. So it was first published in 1836. Then later republished along with Johannes Agricola's Meditation under the title Madhouse Cells. Anyway, this one is the first short dramatic monologue written by Robert Browning. And the poem examines the abnormal psychology of an artist. Abnormal psychology of an artist. Let me tell you something. During Victorian period, the common theme that you can see in the works of all writers is about artist. Okay. Yeah, the common subject is art and artist. So in all these poems, you can see they are posing a question. Is it mandatory that an artist has to be moral? Whether he has to follow any moral codes? Because I told you there is nothing called moral or immoral. Basically, this universe is a product of a big bang. It's full of chaos. So how can you expect to be order in a utterly disorder world? Utterly disordered world. How can one remain to be order in a disordered world? So actually being moral or being trying to become systematic in a chaotic world is actually abnormal, isn't it? So he examines abnormal psychology of an artist in this poem. Browning's monologues are frequently, what I told you, all his characters are lunatic. Most of his characters are lunatic or eccentric or someone who is under emotional stress. So that is nothing, because Robert Browning himself, even though he had a very happy married life, unlike other poets, his marriage life was stress-free, full of romance. But you can see his career. He wasn't that well established as his wife. Maybe he might have portrayed his inner conflicts through his characters. Okay. Now, so Porphyria, as well as my Last Duchess, that is also another monologue. He has used similar type of exposition. Exposition means, what do you mean by exposition? The very beginning of the character. I mean, a stage where the writer introduces the main character and the setting is said to be exposition. So he has used similar type of exposition in this poem and another poem titled My Last Duchess. Okay, so in this particular poem, he tries to objectify. He tried to objectify women from subjectification. Okay. At the beginning of the poem, women, the particular woman, the beautiful woman, was presented as a subject, the main subject. But towards the end of the poem, we can see that she has become an object. Okay. And also, there is one more theme. I told you that life is transient, life is temporary, whereas art is permanent. Isn't it? Life is temporary, art is permanent. So in all these poems, you can see that transience of life versus permanence of art. You can see the conflict. See, towards the end of the poem, after discussing this poem, I will get you the details. Now, the poem Porphyria's Lover by Robert Browning. The rain set early into night. The sullen wind was soon awake. It tore the elm tops down for spite, and did it was to vex the lake. I listened with heart fit to break. When glided in Porphyria straight, she shut the cold out and the storm, and kneeled and made the cheerless grate blaze up on all the cottage warm. Which done, she rose and from her foam withdrew the dripping cloth shawl and laid her soiled glove by, untied her hat and let the damp hair fall. And last she sat down by my side and called me when no voice replied. Okay, so one rainy night, a beautiful lady entered a house. Okay, and she blazed up the entire cottage. She blazed up the entire cottage. And what happened? After that, she removed her dress. She removed her gloves. Then she untied her hair. Then she called her lover. Her lover was lying in the bed. He was lying in the bed and he paid no attention to her. Okay, see, let me tell you, the one who is lying in the bed was the lover of this lady. Porphyria. Porphyria's lover was lying in the bed. So one night, one rainy night, she happened to come into that quarters. Okay, so in order to make the cottage warm, she blazed up the fireplace. After removing her cloak, she came and sat near by her lover. Even though she tried to encourage him, he didn't respond to her call. Okay, then she put her hand around her lover. Then she she made many approaches, but he remained intact. Then towards the end, he has seen Porphyria's love for him. At that moment, he identified and he realized that this lady loved him so much, but the social constraints, the particular lady belonged to upper class family, and he is an artist who is not that flourished or well developed. So it is impossible for him to be in touch with Porphyria forever, or he cannot make her own. For that reason, an intense desire was born in him to make her his own forever. So you know what he did? He strangled her to death. Actually, I told you she had untied her long hairs. He has taken her long hair and thrice he winds around her neck, and he strangled her to death. So let me tell you, at the time of her death, she, according to the lover, she didn't make any noise. She didn't cry. She was very happy when her lover did so, because it is obvious that they cannot marry. They cannot unite. So at least he can capture the infinity of that moment. Infinity of that moment. Being an artist. Being an artist. See, Porphyria is now. Porphyria is with him. But tomorrow she won't be with him. Maybe she will be married off. So in order to capture the very beauty of that art, the beauty of the art, or preserve that eternity of the art, he decided to kill her. And he strangled. See, imagine for no reason only, I mean Porphyria's lover killed her. See, imagine she came to him, she tried to encourage him. She approached him in many ways to make love. Still he didn't respond to her call. Okay, but towards the end, when he realized that Porphyria loved him truly, at that moment he decided to kill her and he strangled her to death. So when he strangled her to death, he says that her blood rushed to her face and her face is more rosy than ever. At the time of her death, she was very happy. That means lover herself, beloved herself has given consent to the lover to kill her. Actually, our lover, artist, or the character in the poem is an eccentric, is an artist. He's trying to justify himself, his act. And he is asking God whether he has done whatever thing he has done, whether it is correct or not. But he tries to justify that because he receives no answer in return. So he justifies his own act that he's actually he actually perpetualized that moment. That's the reason that he gives to for killing Porphyria. That is a very gist of the poem Porphyria's Lover. Let me tell you this. I told you this poem is psychological. Poem has got some psychological importance because the very character is abnormal. So a mad lover. Many critics have given many reasons for killing Porphyria. So Porphyria can be, this is symbolic. Some says that this is a symbolic poem. Porphyria can be some disease that has afflicted the speaker. Some disease afflicted the people towards the end. He's contouring. He's overcoming that disease. In another way, in some other critics says that Porphyria is an art. Art, a beautiful piece of art. And the lover or the artist, obviously artist will be worshipping his art. So he's trying to perpetualize it. That is why I told you at the beginning of the poem, Porphyria, a beautiful woman, the subject of the poem becomes the object of the poem. Towards the end, she becomes the object. And some other critic says that he killed her because of his sexual frustration. He was unable to satisfy Porphyria. That could be another reason why he killed her. Third reason. Okay. And some other critic says that he's a schizophrenic. He is a schizophrenic because he says that even God justified his act. That could be his own voice. Being a schizophrenic, he says that he heard some voice from his head. That voice told him to kill Porphyria. That voice could be his own voice. Being a schizophrenic, he could have killed. That might be the reason he killed Porphyria. Okay. So the very psychology of or the theme of Porphyria is quite confusing. Okay. And I also told you, unlike other PD, other centuries, Restoration, Elizabethan period, Victorian period they have given great importance to morality. Okay, so sex before marriage is taken as is considered profane. Okay, maybe that can be also reason why lover killed beloved for her indecent advancement towards him. So there are n number of reasons, I mean, given to the very murder of Porfiria. Now the next poem is Bishop orders his tomb at St. Prax Church. So I told you this is the first blank verse, in first blank verse dramatic monologue in English. Bishop orders his tomb at St. Prax Church. Now, published in 1845, and the very character of this poem is very corrupted. The bishop orders his tomb. So in this poem, the dying bishop is surrounded by his nephews. Actually, they are not his nephews, but his own illegitimate sons. He's asking them to construct, to build a tomb. So has to, I mean, defeat his rival, in love and life. That is Father Gandalf. Now let's see the poem. Vanity, saith preacher, vanity, grow around my bed. Anselm keeping back. Nephew's son mine, son's mine. A God I not well. So I told you the bishop is lying in his dead bed. He's calling his sons one by one. Anselm keeping back. So he's calling them nephews. When in public he calls them nephews. Actually, they are not his nephews, but his own illegitimate sons. Okay, she men would have to be your mother once. Old Gandalf envied me, so fair she was. So he is disclosing everything to his children that she, your mother, was very beautiful. And this bishop got that beautiful woman as a prize money. Okay, so not only him, but also other bishop, old Gandalf, also, I mean, participated in that contest to win her hand, but it is he who was able to win her hand. So that his rival priest, that rival bishop, his name is Gandalf. He was so jealous of him because this bishop has got the chance to love that fair lady. Okay, so what done is done. She is dead beside dead long ago. I am bishop since. So this lady, that lady had died long ago, and he became a bishop after that. So let me tell you, the bishop in this poem, he received or he accepted that particular profession not out of his spiritual thoughts or not because of his spiritual ideas, okay, but to recover from that shock. I mean, he has lost his wife. And also to amass money. Actually, he is a person who's looking for a greater existence in life. Okay. He's not spiritual, but he's very worldly in nature. That is why he calls his son nephews in public, but in secret he knows that they are his children, and he says to them that your mother, she was very beautiful. I got her as a prize money. And another bishop, his name is Gandalf. He was very jealous of me because I married your. I got a chance to woo your mom. Anyway, that beautiful lady is no more. Ever since then, I became a priest. Okay. As she died, so we must die ourselves. And then you may perceive the world's a dream. Life, how and what is it? And here I lie in this state chamber, dying by degrees, hours and long hours in the dead night. I ask, do I live? Am I dead? Peace seems all. Saint Prax ever was the church for peace. Okay. Anyway, let me tell you, this person is not fit for the church. Because he doesn't have any religious mind or religious attitude. He's full of worldly thoughts, race, competition. Like that. So at this moment, he called his sons only to give some advice. Because See, his rival bishop's name is Gandalf. Gandalf died some years ago, and that particular priest was, I mean, he was quite successful in occupying, I mean, a space in the church. That church, I mean, that particular space is quite popular. So anyway, our bishop hadn't got that chance to reserve for his tomb. See, actually, he's giving advice to his sons to build a tomb for him before his death. Before his death, he is giving instructions to build his tomb. Okay, so even though he hasn't got that space in the churchyard, at least he wanted to surpass his rival or his opponent Gandalf in the way of the construction of his tomb. So he's asking them to build his tomb using costly, expensive marbles, imported marbles. And he's also asking them to make an effigy of, I mean, the very statue of, to carve his own statue in that tomb, and also to place the lapis lazuli, the very precious stone which he had got from a church. And he compares the church, sorry, the very color of the lapis lazuli to the vein that is running on the bosom of Virgin Mary. He says that, see, the lapis lazuli is blue in color, and the vein that runs through the bosom of Virgin Mary is also blue in color. So he compares the very color of lapis lazuli with that of the vein that runs through the bosom. And apart from that, he says that it is as big as a Jew's head. It is as big as a Jew's head. Then he also told them to make all kind of preparations, just like see, when Egyptian pharaohs die, I mean their followers will make preparation for their final journey, isn't it? The pyramid will be filled with jewels, servants, fruits, like that. Similarly, he's also asking his sons, illegitimate sons, to fill his tomb with precious things, vase full of fruits, then his effigy, and he asked them to place that lapis lazuli not on his head, the precious stone not on his head. Instead, he asked his sons to place that lapis lazuli at his feet, because whoever comes to see his tomb, they will first look at his feet. See, from this you can understand what kind of a person he is. He's a very power hungry person, and he is also a hedonist. Yes, he's a pleasure seeking priest. He's a pleasure seeking priest. And apart from that, he is lying exactly opposite of, he is going to lie, not lying, he's going to lie exactly opposite of his opponent Gandalf. So Gandalf, from his tomb, he will look at him. So his attention will be first drawn to that lapis lazuli, and so he's asking to place that gem at his feet. So whoever comes, they will first look into his feet. So he'll be elevated to the position of a god. So this person is very mean, okay? Anyway, so he is actually bribing his sons, okay? If they don't follow him, if they don't follow his orders, obviously he is not. See, this person has amassed a lot of wealth, and he has many villas and bungalows in his name. So if his sons are following his orders, then obviously after his death, he will I mean, he will make such a provision that he will give all his wealth and mansions to his sons. If they don't follow, if they don't construct a tomb, or yeah, if they don't follow his instruction, obviously he will hand over all his wealth to the Pope of England, to the Pope of England. Apart from that, see, if they are following the very instructions, then he will ask the Virgin Mary to give them beautiful marble skin wife. Apart from that, to give them a better place in heaven, then to give them holy scriptures. Okay, so these are the things, these are the advices that he had given to his illegitimate sons. Okay, so very simple poem. Anyway, let me tell you, this poem is a kind of a satire, because it questions the inconsistency, pride, hypocrisy, and ignorance in some kind of fake art. See, in fake artists, okay, he's actually ridiculing those fake artists. Yeah, the next spot. One second. The irony in the poem we have discussed early. Now, next poem is Fra Lippulippi. So, Fra Lippulippi is also a poem by Robert Browning. That is also a dramatic monologue taken from the collection of Men and Women. In this poem also, he presents a chaotic painter. Who's actually a priest. But he hasn't... he is not true to his profession. I mean, he is a painter. First and foremost, he is a painter. But he is not that true to his priesthood profession. Okay. Anyway, this is very... It's a very interesting poem. So he's asking, an artist should be true to life. He shouldn't be a Hippocratic. Okay, he shouldn't be Hippocratic like our bishop. So in this poem only he questions whether an artist had an obligation to be moral, whether he should be moral in nature. There is nothing like that, I told you. So the poem views the relationship between art and morality. Then poem has got a double purpose. See, an art is a medium. That is also a medium to amass money, earn money. So I do pecuniary as well as creative. Now, Fra Lippulippi, I'm a poor brother Lippo by your leave. You need not clap your posh to my face. So let me tell you, Fra Lippulippi is a painter who lived during the 13th century. He lost his father and mother at a very young age. And he was left alone in the street. From there, he was taken by his aunt. At the age of 8, he was sent to monastery of Carmelite priest. Okay. Anyway, they tried to teach him Latin and other subjects. But he was least interested in all those scriptures. And one of the monks, they found that he is most he was mostly interested in painting pictures. But let me tell you, this man was a realistic painter. He's a realistic painter. So he painted, he had spent so many years in street. So he had got a chance to study different types of faces. Faces of thieves, prostitutes. I mean, common people, commonplace people. Okay. But so anyway, let me tell you, he gave importance to what he had seen. Okay. So the priests or monks of the church or the monastery, they have advised him not to paint the flesh. Okay, not to paint the flesh. Instead, she should see the soul of the people. Okay. Being a realistic painter, beauty comes first, isn't it? Beauty or the, you need a medium. You need, first you need a medium, that is body first, then only you can enter into the soul. Okay, so even though he doesn't like what he is doing, he suppressed it and started to paint what he had been told to do. Okay, so this poem mainly concentrates around the conflicts faced by a painter in a very constrained sense, in a very constrained ambience. Okay, see, an artist or a poet, whatever, whoever, okay, he should be given freedom. He should be given his own space. But our Fra Lippo Lippi is very much restricted. Okay, now let's see. I am poor brother Lippo, by your leave, you need not clap your torches to my face. Sooks, what is to blame? You think you see a monk? What is past midnight? You go rounds, and here you can catch me at Ellie's end. Poor sportive ladies leave their doors ajar. So, one night, Fra Lippo Lippi, he was staying in a in a mansion of a very rich person. Okay. So from there, while he was painting, he happened to see some sportive ladies laughing and moving in the street. And they entered to a, they entered her house, and the door of the house was left open. Okay. So anyway, Fra Lippo Lippi, our priest, our painter come priest, he followed those sportive, I mean, ladies. So anyway, he was caught by a watchman. He was caught by a watchman. So he is trying to justify himself. I am a poor brother Lippo. By your leave, please leave me. You need not clap your torch on me. There's no need to lighten your torch. Don't blame me. You think you see a monk? What is it past midnight? You go round. So he's explaining that he is a monk. So obviously the watchman will too will have doubts regarding why the particular person is following that sportive ladies, those prostitutes, that too at midnight. Carmine, my cloister, hunt it up. Do hurry out if you must show your zeal. Whatever rat there hath on his wrong mole, and nip each softling of a weak white mouse, weak, weak, that creep to keep him company. Ah, no, you better, then you will take your hands away, fiddling on my throat. See, I belong to Carmine group of priests. Okay, see, I haven't done any mistake. I was simply following them. When I saw a piece of art, I simply followed them. If you come to know who am I, then obviously you will take your hands from my throat. So please try to know who am I. Thereafter, Fra Lippo Lippi says his own story, that he what I have told, that he was an orphan, taken later. He was looked after by his aunt. Then after that, she handed over him to monks or priests. Okay. Then staying in that church, he became a painter, and he started to paint the pics of people that he met in the street. Okay. So his even though the priest has given him many advices, actually, he had got a basic instinct to follow the very, nature. Okay, Anyway, he was compelled to take the advice of the priest, and he started painting the church. Okay. So anyway, he tried to justify himself in front of that watchman, and he begs the in front of the watchman that if the watchman let him go free, then he will paint a church in England within 6 months. It's more or less like a story, you can easily understand. Next poem is Shire Rowland to the Dark Tower Came. The very hero of this poem is Robert Browning himself. Written in 1852, it is written in the form of a fairy tale. Okay, it published in 1855. Title Shire Rowland to Dark Tower Came, which forms the last word of the poem, is a line taken from William Shakespeare's play King Lear. The title is taken from King Lear, Shakespeare's King Lear. Then it is full of what images? The setting is medieval. The poem has got a medieval setting, and the central character is a knight. That knight is none but Robert Browning himself. I told you he was at early stage, at the beginning of his career. He was not that successful at the beginning of his career, so he had some kind of confusions, and he was in a state of utter dismay. So he is continuing his journey. I mean, the person, the knight, who had set forth his journey, who had set forth for something, is none but Browning himself, looking for a meaning, for his life. Yeah, my first thought was he lied in every word. The hoary cripple with malicious eye askance to watch the working of his lie. So I told you this poem is poem had medieval setting, and apart it is written in the form of a fairy tale. So my first thought was Browning, or the speaker, or the particular person who is continuing his journey through unknown place. He happened to encounter. He happened to meet a hoary cripple, a monster. Who was sitting on a stone? He has got a malicious eyes. So actually, in he ha actually he hasn't met any person to ask about that particular place. He is the only person that in that I mean he has seen in that place. Okay, so he stopped there. Robert Browning, or the speaker or narrator, stopped there to ask about the very course of the journey, where this path leads to. On mind and the mouth scarce able to afford suppression of the glee and the pursued and scorn, it edged at one more victim gained by thereby. Okay, so that hoary cripple, or the monster, or that beast became very happy. He suppressed his happiness. See, let me tell you, this is an allegory. This is an allegory. Allegory means where vices and virtues are personified. So, just like in knightly stories or medieval stories, there will be some monster, or an evil-minded person or a wicked person in the middle of a journey, where the particular person is trying to mislead the speaker. He's trying to mislead the speaker and making him to take some other path. So see, that particular monster or hoary crippled, aged crippled person who was sitting on the stone, he was so happy to see the speaker or Robert Browning or the narrator, because he got one more prey. So he's suppressing his happiness. Actually, I got one more prey. What else should he left for with his staff? So what saved Waylay with his lie and snare? He has trapped one more person or travelers who might find him posted there and ask the road, I guess, what skull like laugh and would break, what crushed grin write my epitaph. So before Robert Browning, so many other person had taken this course, has taken this way. All those people hadn't returned. Okay. So, see, he doesn't know what is ahead of him. And he continues his journey. See, let me tell you, on the way, he encounters different types of dangers. It is a very narrow path, very steep, narrow path. And he has seen the skeletons of previous travelers. And he encounters a river in the middle, and somehow he is able to cross that river, and finally he reaches his destination, that is the Dark Tower. See, whoever tried to reach that Dark Tower, they all had lost their path and they have been returned. But our knight, that is Robert Browning, he reached that tower. But what is inside that tower is not mentioned. Okay. So that tower could be, something that Robert Browning was really scared of. That could be his the tower could be his profession, career, or his unfulfilled dreams. Okay, so the very journey is nothing. That very allegorical journey undertaken by the speaker in this poem is actually the very mental state of the hero, who is struggling to establish his career. Robert Browning. And the hoary cripple is nothing but obstacles. The obstacles he had in his profession. Okay. Now, if you read this poem, you will feel that, it is a fairy tale, but it is more than a fairy tale. It's a symbolic poem. Yeah, so when the poem opens, see Roland, the knight, child Roland. The very term child, that is a term given to a person who's aspiring to become a knight, just like a squire. In medieval English, child is a term given to a person who's aspiring to become a knight. So child Roland, when he had seen that person, that aged person, that means crippled person, he had some kind of speculation, whatever details given by that particular person is not true, that he knows it very well, but he has no other option. He takes the same path. He is full of doubt. Roland is full of doubt. Okay, so the gloomy, cynical Roland seeks the tower and undergoes various hardship on the way. I have told you, we have discussed the point. Yeah. So, as I said, a tower can be seen as a symbol of damnation of a being. Sometime that is the target, or that is what Robert Browning is searching for, or it can be heaven, it can be his death. That tower can symbolize tower symbolizes many things. Anyway, it also gives a great message that only after consecutive failures one will understand the greater reality of truth. Okay. Anyway, it is Margaret Atwood, Canadian writer, who first told that Child Roland in this poem is none but Robert Browning himself. Now the next poem is Sordello. Sordello, as I said, one of the most difficult poems ever written in English. It is with this poem this man has lost all his reputations. And the poem was published in 1840. This is a history in verse. Sordello is a history in verse. This is a historical poem. Now, as I told you, this is notoriously famous for his obscurity, because he has altered the history. Now, just like Child Roland, this is also a psychological poem. The very person, Sordello, is none but. Sordello is an artist, is a court poet, a troubadour. Previously, he was a street poet. Later, he becomes a court poet and full of confusions. So Sordello is none but Robert Browning itself. Okay. Now, the particular character has been torn between the very practicality and sublimity in the practical side of life and the sublimity of art. Okay. After knowing the secret behind his birth, or the very story of his childhood, he was badly ruptured, and he is leaving the palace. That is the story of Sordello. One second. So let's see the very lineage of Sordello, the history of Sordello. Okay, the particular poem is set in North Italy in around 13th century, first half of 13th century, 1220. So during that period, Italy was politically unrest. Country was struggling between Guelphs and Ghibellines. Guelphs were led by partisans, followers of Pope. And Ghibellines were the followers of Roman Emperor. So let me tell you, Sordello. Sordello is actually the son of Torello Salinguera and Retrude. Okay, Sordello, who was first introduced in the poem as a street poet, an orphan street poet. He doesn't know who his parents are. Okay. So actually, Sordello is the son of Torello Salinguera and Retrude. Retrude is the daughter of German Emperor Frederick II. So he is royal in origin. Okay, this person, Sordello, is not an orphan but royal in origin. But when the poem opens, he is presented as a wandering poet. Okay, so Sordello is a Ghibelline. Because his father is a Ghibelline, follower of Roman Emperor. So Torello Salinguera is a soldier and friend of Eclino II. Okay, Eclino II. And Eclino II was defeated by Guelphs, and he was made to flee from Italy. Okay. From that particular place. So he became very angry, before leaving Italy, he set fire to that place. Torello Salinguera, at that time, he was away from there. Okay. And Retrude was pregnant with Sordello. Not only Retrude, but Eclino's wife was also pregnant with his son. So in that fire, Retrude was badly burned, And he was saved by an archer, a troop. And Eclino's wife, Adelaine, was saved by an archer. Eclino has two wives. Augustine Est, she was a Guelph, his wife. His first wife is Augustine Est. And Palma is a, Palma was born in that relation. Okay. Then next son is Eclino and Cunnisa. Eclino 3 and Cunnisa were born in his relationship with Adelaide. So, you know, I told you Torello, Salinguera was away from that place. When Eclino 2 set fire in the Guelph city. Okay. So anyway, Archer saved Retro, Adelaide, and Eclino 3. So anyway, soon after reaching the palace, Retro, Sordello's mother, passed away. So anyway, Adelaide told the archer to keep the very parentage or the very parenthood of Sordello as secret, because she thought that someday Sordello will become rival to her son Eclino III. For that reason, she told the archer to keep the very parentage of Sordello as a secret. Okay, so yeah, so like that, Adelaide had taken Sordello as a page to his son, as a servant to his son. Like that, he was leading his life, and he fell in love with Palma. So he spent his days daydreaming about Palma. Like that, one day, he leaves this city and he headed to Mantua. Sordello, your portion mentioned in block 8 is Sordello in Mantua. He continued his journey to Mantua. It's from there book starts. Book 2 starts. I mean, the one that is in the syllabus starts with Sordello's journey to Mantua. Okay. Let's see that. The evening star was high when he reached Mantua, but his fame arrived. Before him, friends applauded Guscan Knight. Nado looked an angel, the rest angels, and all these angels would be blessed supremely by song, thrice renowned. Oito manufactured, then he found, casting about to satisfy the crowd, that happy vehicle so late allowed. So a sore annoyance, it was the song effect he cared for, scarce the song itself reflect in the past life. What might be singing used just to delight in aliens whose profuse praise toilsome process which procured that praise enticed Apollo, dreams abjured. So he is heading towards Mantua, a place in Italy. Yeah. 1 second. So he knows, see, I told you Sordello, just like Apollo. Last week we have seen Hyperion. Hyperion, where you have seen the very birth of Lord Apollo and the death of Hyperion. Similarly, this book too speaks about the birth of the book 2 speaks about the birth of Sordello and Death of the Court Poet Eglamour. Okay, Eglamour. Previously, before the arrival of Sordello, Eglamour was the troubadour or the court poet in Mantua. So, this Sordello's childhood and youth as an orphan page was in Goito. Goito is a place in Italy, okay? He spent his childhood life in Goito. From there only, he started his journey to Mantua, okay? So when he reached Mantua, some celebration was taking place there. His friends, enemies, everyone was there, okay? And Nado is a jongler who was the assistant of Eglamour. He was an opportunist. Nado was a servant of Eglamour. So Eglamour was the court poet. So when this person Sordello reached there, Eglamour was singing. Okay. Anyway, he too participated in the competition, and he was able to defeat Eglamour. Even though Eglamour blessed him that night itself, Eglamour died. Okay. Okay, thereafter Nado joins Sordello. So that is the very gist of book two. Let me tell you, thereafter he discovers the secret of his birth and his parentage, that he was not an orphan. He actually belongs to the royal line. His mother was the daughter of an emperor, isn't it? Retro. So he is not a common man, but belongs to noble class or royal people, royal line. Okay. So after understanding the truth about his birth, he leaves the palace. So has to make his poet, make his language more appropriate, or to give greater vision to his life. Okay, even though he was prevented by Palma, his lady love, he was divided. Actually, he was deeply divided between his profession and his destiny. Okay. Anyway, after that, Adelaide, towards the end, she discloses everything to Eclino too, that Sordello is none but he is the son of Torello Salinguera and Retro. After that, she dies. Eclino too, after the death of Adelaide, he retired to monastery, and Torello became the next emperor. You may please try to read the very history of Sordello Salinguera. Okay. Now the next poem is Dante Gabriel Rossetti's Blessed Damsel. So he belonged to the class of Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood. Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood was founded by William Holman Hunt and John Everett Millais. The poets of the Pre-Raphaelite poets, they admired Florentine painters, pre-Raphaelites. Raphael was a famous poet, and pre-Raphaelites means painters before Raphael. Okay, painters before Raphael, in Italy during 14th century. Okay, so let me tell you, according to pre-Raphaelites poet, painters before Raphael, they were much more dedicated and sincere to their work than Raphael, and they are more realistic, because Raphael and his followers were bit artificial. According to them, they were a bit artificial in their approach towards art. But pre-Raphaelites painters, I mean painters before Raphaelites, were quite realistic. That is why these poets followed, admired their tradition. So D.J. Rossetti, Dante Gabriel Rossetti, William Holman Hunt, and John Everett Millais, they followed painters before Raphael. Yeah. So anyway, these works of these writers included European symbolism, and was a major precursor of aesthetic movement. I told you, what is aesthetic movement? Art for art's sake. Art is free of that moral, immoral issues. Okay. It's art is above all. Art is created for created for pure enjoyment. Okay. Now, so sensuality and medievalism, are the features of his poetry. And his early poetry was influenced by John Keats. Now, in Blessed Damsel, he has actually imitated Keats, but this poem, Blessed Damsel, is inspired by Edgar Allan Poe's Raven. Edgar Allan Poe is an American poet. His poem Raven, in which lover has been lost in the thought of his deceased beloved. At that time, an ominous bird, Raven, comes, and he is recalling about his deceased lover. Similarly, in this Blessed Damsel, beloved is in heaven. Beloved is in heaven, and she is recalling about her lover on earth. In Raven, lover on earth is recalling, thinking about his lover in heaven. Exactly opposite. Okay, so that is why I told you this poem is inspired by Raven, written by Edgar Allan Poe, an American poet of the early 19th century. Okay, now, so his both his painting and writings were characterized by mysticism, full of rich, sensuous image. Okay, so Rossetti is mostly famous for his ballads and sonnets. Now, let's see. His most famous poem is Blessed Damsel. So I have already described what is Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood. Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood, I told you, it was founded in 1848 by Holman Hunt, John Millais, and Rossetti. And sculptor Thomas Woolner. Those poets of 19th century who followed Florentine painters before Raphael. Okay, Raphael is a very, even though Raphael is very famous, than those painters, those ordinary painters, commonplace painters of Italy, these poets followed them because they were more sincere and devoted to their work than Raphael. That is the reason why this poet followed them. Now, we have already discussed the features: medievalism, mysticism, then sensuality were the qualities of Pre-Raphaelite poets. Then obviously picturesque quality, love, symbolism of love, the musical quality, etc. Now, Blessed Damsel, published in 1850 in Pre-Raphaelite journal Germ, inspired by the poem Raven by Edgar Allan Poe. Now, let's see. The Blessed Damsel leaned out from the golden bar of heaven. Her eyes were deeper than the depth of water stilled at even. She had three lilies in her hand, and the stars in her hair. Verse 7. So blessed damsel, I told you, she's a virgin, and she was parted from her lover on earth. It had been so many years. Now she is in the heaven. Now from there she is looking down for her earthly lover. Her eyes were deeper than the depth of water still that even. Okay. She had three lilies in her hand and stars in her hair were 7. So let me tell you, if you see the if you look at the picture of Virgin Mary, you can see you can see her holding lilies and 7 stars in her hair shows 7 archangels. Okay, her robe ungirded from clasp to hem, no robe flowers did adorn, but a white rose of Mary's gift. Okay, her dress was very simple. She had only a white rose on her dress that was gifted by Virgin Mary. It shows that she was as pure as Virgin Mary. Okay, her service neatly worn. Her hair that lay along her back was yellow like ripe corn. Let me tell you, this lady is very beautiful. What? She is in heaven just because of her service that she has done on earth. But even though she is heaven, she is not happy with her current status, because she is all alone in heaven. I mean, she feels that she is all alone, or she is incomplete without her lover on earth. Okay, so she is looking forward to that day when she can join with her lover. Now, so as I told you, she is looking down on earth and she is searching for a earthly lover. Anyway, the place where she is standing is so high. She could hardly see the sun and earth below it. Okay, now see. Yeah. See, so many other maidens have been elevated. So many maidens like her has been elevated to heaven from earth. Okay. See, anyway, see, normally we say that life with God or life with life among angels, Mary is very blissful, is very happy. Yes, she is she is blessed. She is happy, but still she feels incomplete. Okay, so yeah, lilies. I told you she is holding lilies. That is as fresh as okay, then yeah, she has seen Mary and her followers making robes for maiden ladies that are entering the heaven. Now yeah, and in this poem she believes that someday she will be able to rejoin or reunite with his with her lover. And she is dreaming, she is anticipating that when he comes, he'll be also dressed in white, and together they will sing the song of God. And Virgin Mary on behalf of her will ask to the Father and will get the sanction for their marriage, and in front of the Father, Spirit and Son, they will be, the marriage will be solemnized. Even though she couldn't unite with her lover on earth, she'll be able to unite with her lover on earth with a medium, with the help of Virgin Mary. But towards the end of the poem, she understands that it is only a dream. She couldn't actually reunite with her lover. That is what has been told in Blessed Damsel. Even though the title states that she is blessed, she is not actually happy. One second. Oh, hello, sir. Yeah. Once again. The next poem is My Sister's Sleep. Poem by D.J. Rossetti, published in 1850 in Pre-Raphaelite Journal. Yeah, so this poem where speaker talks about the very death of his sister and how the family accepts that fact. Yeah, My Sister's Sleep. The fact that she fell asleep means that she is died. She is having the eternal sleep. Now, we can see that in this poem, how her sibling and her mother is preparing her for the final journey. Okay. See, the poem is remarkable for describing the characters for their genuine gesture. See, it is not quite DJ Rossetti hasn't exaggerated, made any exaggeration in this poem. He has genuinely described the very gestures of the sibling and the mother. And they how they accept the fact that his sister or her daughter is no more. Yeah, she fell asleep on a Christmas Eve at the length, the long ungrated shade of weary eyelids overweight, the pain not else might yet relieve. Okay. She passed away on a Christmas Eve. So this time she has closed, she has said goodbye to all her earthly sufferings. Anyway, has a brother, of course he is very dejected, he is very sad. But on other side, he is happy because she had said goodbye to all her earthly worries. Our mother, who had lain all day over the bed from time to time, then raised herself for the first time as she sat her down, did pray. Her mother, her sibling and her mother, they remain silent all throughout the day without disturbing her, because obviously she is about to die. She is about to die, and so she will be having some kind of difficulty. So in order to make her passage, her journey smooth, they remained in that room without making any noise. The only noise that can be heard in that room is the sound of clock. Okay, her little work table was spread with work to finish for the glare made by her candle, and she care to work some distance from the bed. So mother was silently doing her knitting work. without disturbing her daughter. Okay, so this is a very simple poem where the speaker or the narrator presents the death of his sibling, his younger sister. Obviously, death is inevitable. And yeah, the most saddest part of the life. But still, he is happy for something that she had bid farewell to all her worries. Actually, she had been suffering from some disease for a long time, but now she has she got a relief from that. So they should be happy. At least she got freedom from all those things, isn't it? Now she is. Now they are preparing for her final journey. That is the very summary of My Sister's Leave. See, let me tell you, I already told you these poets are not artificial in nature. Pre-Raphaelite poets, they are not artificial. You cannot see any kind of exaggerated imagery or comparisons, unlike Spencer, Chaucer, Keats. You cannot see, but they have portrayed life as it is. That is a peculiarity of Victorian work. Now, the next poem is Lobin Market by Christina Rossetti. Christina Rossetti is none but the sister of B.J. Rossetti. Okay. So, an English poet, romantic, devotional, and she is also a feminist. Okay. Because in her poem, she hasn't portrayed any of the, you cannot see any male figures in her poem. And she is a very religious poet. Okay. She was also a member of Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood. And she wrote poems and essays for Pre-Raphaelite Journal, that is John. And she is mostly famous for this poem, Lobin Market, which has been included in your syllabus. Lobin, once again. It's a narrative poem, just like Child Roland. This one is also more or less like a fairy tale. So the poem tells the story of two sisters, Laura and Lizzie. An allegory, yeah. Now, this is an allegory, okay. Who are tempted with fruits by goblin merchants. See, goblin merchants. I told you there are no male figures in this poem. Not only in this poem, but being a feminist, an early feminist, okay, in her works, you cannot see any dominant male figures. These goblin merchants are representative of males, but they are presented as monsters, okay. Instead of presenting them as males, poet has presented them as monsters. It also talks about the feminine sexuality. And yeah, but let me tell you, some critics say that it talks about homosexuality, which was against Victorian tradition. Anyway, I told you Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood poets are free from moral codes or such kind of things. They portray life passages. So, and this poem can be also seen as a parable of female resistance and solidarity. Allegory. Now, let's see. Goblin Market. Morning, evening, maids heard Robin cry. Come buy our orchard fruits. Come by. So there are two characters. One is Laura, another one is Lizzie. Okay. Yeah. So early morning, they heard the cry of goblin merchants. I mean, goblin are not males, but they are having the body of males, but they have been given the face of beast, animals. So they are calling out people to buy fruits from them. Apple, quinces, lemon, oranges, plum, unplucked cherries, melons, raspberries. So they are having different kinds of fruits. Swat-headed mulberries, wild-free bone canberries, pineapples, blackberry, apricot, strawberries. Okay, like that. In summer weather, moon that pass by, fairy eaves that fly. Come by, come by. So this is summertime. It's the best time to eat fruit. So come and buy fruits from us. Our grapes fresh from vine. Pomegranates full and fine. Dates sharp and laces and rare pears and green gauges. Damsons, blueberries, taste them and try. Currants, gooseberries, ripe fair like barberries. So they are asking. Actually these goblin merchants are mainly targeting females, unmarried females to buy fruits from them. Okay. So Laura and I told you, Laura and Lizzie, sisters. So Laura, when she heard the call of goblin merchant, she was tempted. And she wanted to buy fruits from them. So she exchanged her lock for that fruit, and she devoured it. And she became very much addicted to that fruit, and she kept on eating it. So one fine day, she fell sick. She had severe stomach pain. Okay. So anyway, after that, when she approached the goblin merchant, they haven't given her any fruits. But they were ready to give fruits to her sister, Lizzie. But Lizzie, unlike Laura, she is very religious. She's very strict. But in order to save her sister, she went to goblin merchants and she paid that silver penny. So anyway, the goblin merchants tried to make her eat that fruits from them. But Lizzie, she is clever than her sister Laura. She controlled herself and she doesn't eat any fruit from them. So goblin merchants, those bees, they have, they poured the juice on her face and tried their best to make her drink that juice. Anyway, she ran with her life from there and she asked her sister to lick that. Actually, the juice that they have poured on Lizzie's face will work as an antidote to her venom. That poison in Laura's body. So Lizzie asked her sister to lick it from her body. So like that, Laura has licked that juice from Lizzie's face. Yeah, Laura licked that juice from Lizzie's face. And she recovered. So this shows the solidarity and the very resistance of a female. Okay, yeah. So apart from that, the episode where Lizzie offers her body. Smeared with fruit juice to Laura. That shows, according to some critic, that highlights the homosexuality relationship between two sisters. Okay. Now, see, if you are more religious, you will see the religious side of this poem. But if you are, a student of gender studies or sexual politics, obviously, you will see the sensual aspect in this poem. Okay, because the silver penny which Lizzie offered to goblins, that can be seen as the female productive organ which she tried to using which she tried to lure the goblins. But anyway, she hasn't surrendered in front of them, but instead she tries to lure them. So has to get the antidote from the goblin merchants. Okay. Anyway, towards the end of the poem, Laura recovered. Lizzie and Laura are shown with their children. Both are happy. Okay, anyway, even though they are shown as married women, none of the you can see that no female figures are described or portrayed in the poem. So anyway, I told you Victorian England or Victorian period had set such a moral standard for women. So it was a crime. It was considered as a grave mistake to lose virginity before marriage. And Laura's stomach pain, or Laura after eating fruit, she became sick. That can be seen as, a phase of a woman losing her virginity. That is why this poem is a symbolic poem. Okay. Now, Laura. See, Laura doesn't have any kind of restriction and she is loosely moral, whereas Lizzie had high moral values. Now, so many theories can be applied in this poem, that is feminism, Marxism, Freudian theory, queer theory. Like that, you can apply any theory. So Lizzie can be taken as an image of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ offered himself, his body, or his life for the very goodness or for the sake of mankind. Similarly, Lizzie offered her life risked her own life for her sister Laura. And this can be also seen as a parable of lesbian empowerment. Lesbian relationship between two sisters. These two points we have discussed, that Christian allegory and gender and sexuality. Now another point is you can compare the two sisters to Adam and Eve, isn't it? Because just like Eve, who eats the forbidden fruit, Laura too eats the forbidden fruit and tempts Lizzie to eat that. But Lizzie control herself because she is having strict moral values. She overcame that temptation. So we can even relate that episode to, Adam and Eve's story, or else you can compare to Jesus Christ, or else you can even use that lesbian parable. And goblin merchants are none but equivalents of men or Satan. So they are actually goblin merchant are monsters. In this poem, they are presented as monsters, beasts, having animal head with human body, but they are symbolic representation of men or Satan, who are pursuing women, women and their body. Anyway, then Lizzie also has Jesus Christ. I told you Lizzie already has a Jesus Christ image, and Laura has the image of Lazarus. Lizzie is actually resurrecting Laura. Laura has committed a sin that she lost her virginity before marriage by eating that forbidden fruit from goblin merchant. Maybe she has she's conceived. Eating that fruit, she ate that fruit from goblin merchant. The goblin merchant could be a man, and the fruit that she had taken could be the sin of that product. Obviously, she has conceived. So anyway, Lizzie here serves as or works as Jesus Christ, just like Jesus Christ offered his blood and flesh to his disciples. Here, Lizzie offered her Jew's mere body to Laura, and she resurrects just like Jesus resurrected Lazarus. So you can describe this poem in many ways. So there are several interpretations. Okay, now the next poem is Oscar Wilde's poem, The Reading of the Jail. So Oscar Wilde is basically a playwright, an Irish playwright, very popular, the chief exponent of aesthetic movement, art for art's sake. That means you should not attach, you should not give any, you should not adhere any moral values, moral or immoral codes to art. Art is purely meant for art's sake. It's purely meant for enjoyment. There is no good or evil things with art. Okay. And apart from that, this person is a happy or lucky type person. Yeah. But society, just like I mentioned about Robert Browning, his characters are eccentric. His characters has always, they have always broken the path or the very trend of the period. He presented homosexual characters or disordered characters. So obviously, a writer who presents such type of characters in his writing, obviously world will think or they will believe that they are the very resemblance of the writer himself, isn't it? Because previously our Robert Browning has wrote many such type of characters, not this type of homosexual characters, but eccentric, lunatic, someone under emotional stress. So Margaret Atwood said that is not, I mean, all his character resembled him. All those crises felt by his character, experienced by his character, are also experienced by the author. Similarly, Oscar Wilde's characters, I told you, they were iconoclasts. All his characters were iconoclasts. Someone who has gone against the tradition or different from, commonplace ones. Okay. So, critics or the popular, are the eminent people of his period, they thought that all his characters are the exact resemblance of the particular person, and he had been imprisoned for 2 years for his homosexual relationship with a person. Okay, now anyway, so yeah, in 1897, while Oscar Wilde was released, so let me tell you, thereafter, even though he was a very successful writer, very popular, after being imprisoned for 2 years, his writings, his books were not accepted by the publishers. So he was forced to publish under different name. And he went to France so as to regenerate himself. Anyway, in this particular poem, the ballad, The Reading of the Jail, he shares his own experience as an inmate of the jail. And this poem is based on a real incident which he had witnessed in jail. So Ballad of Reading a Jain. So he written he has written this poem when he was in exile after releasing from jail. So the central character that he portrays in the poem is Charles Thomas Bulridge. He's the person he talks about Bulridge, who murdered his wife, Laura Ellen, whom he loved a lot. So in the first section of the poem, the very mental condition of the Bulridge is described. So actually the Bulridge, he is not a single person, but he represents the entire prisoners, okay, and entire mankind. So according to the poet Oscar Wilde, people mostly kill things or person that they love the most. Actually, we are mostly hurt by the people. Now, yeah, so it's a long poem. There are 109 stanza, consist of 6 lines, big poem. It's a long poem. So the Oscar Wilde, just like Thomas Bulridge, or Oscar Wilde was also separated from his wife and son. He also lost his happy married life. This was written in the form of a proletarian ballad. Proletarian ballad means working class. Working class ballad. Okay, so I told you he couldn't publish that poem under his name because of his criminal origin. Okay, I mean criminal background. Now the ballad. He did not wear his scarlet coat, for blood and wine are red, and blood and wine were on his hands when they found him with death. The poor dead woman whom he loved and murdered in her bed. So I told you the poem starts with Charles Thomas Bulridge, who murdered his wife. Actually, he loved his wife very much. He did not wear his scarlet coat, for blood and wine are red. Both blood and wine are red. That on that particular day, the person hasn't worn scarlet coat. He is already red with the blood of his lady love. He walked among the trial men in a suit of shabby gray. A cricket cap was on his head, and his step seemed light and gay. But I never saw a man who looked blissful at that day. So, after murdering his wife, he was taken to the jail. He was wearing a cap. Yeah, his steps were light and gay. See, but he, when Charles Thomas Bulridge was executed, at that time, our Oscar Wilde was in jail. He was imprisoned for 2 years for homosexuality. Okay, he was there in the jail. I never saw a man who looked with such a wistful eye, but he has most peaceful, or peaceful eyes. Even though he committed a murder, he's feeling very light. According to the author, he is the person with most wistful eyes. Upon the light end of blue, which prisoners call the sky, a very drifting cloud that went the sails of silver by. So all other people came there to watch this person, to watch the new inmate to the jail. So the first part of the poem discusses or describes about the prisoner's appearance, emotion, situation. He murdered the person whom he loved the most, but his face doesn't his face doesn't show any kind of emotion. Okay, he was he had taken light steps, and his face was calm. Okay. Now, part two describes the, I mean, how other jail authorities condemn the emotion of the imprisoned person. Okay. See, and let me tell you, all other prisoners expect that the particular person will be depressed. But they are surprised to see that he is not upset. And he is trying to make out the most from the present, from the remain, I mean, from the remaining days, he was trying to make out the most. Okay. Now, in part three, I mean, the emotional indifference which he had in part one and part two, he continues that in part three. And he is waiting for his ex. It is sure obvious that he'll be executed. So, other inmates, they could not sleep before the ex. I mean, the day night before the execution. But this person had taken a sound sleep. So, and while Oscar Wilde and other prisoners, they were anxiously waiting for the next morning. See, actually, Victorian period, this is a kind, this is a satire. This poem is a satire because Victorian poetry or Victorian age set such a high moral course for the people. And see, the particular person is not worried about his life or what is going to happen to him, but other characters, it is other characters who are mostly worried about him. Okay, see, other prisoners were sleepless, but he had taken a sound sleep. Now, in part four, see, other prisoners are, I mean, they are unlocked and so that they can see the grave of that executed man. See, at the, even at the time of the death, or yeah, even though he was lying down lifeless after execution, I mean, jail authorities, they have been paid any kind of respect to the man's body. And why Oscar Wilde believes that finally that man is at peace. He joined his wife. It's for some silly issue, silly trivial thing that he cut the throat of his wife. But thereafter he understood his mistake. That is why he maintained, he hasn't made any plea in front of, I mean, any court or any police officer. He silently, I mean, he accepts everything because he understood that he is wrong, and he accepts his fate. That is why the he had no any he had. Yeah, the particular person doesn't seem to have any kind of emotion. He is emotionally indifferent. He was make yeah, he was celebrating his last days. He I mean, he ate and slept like I mean, like ordinary people. He was least worried about his execution. Okay, while other people, they were mostly concerned about this person. And even Oscar Wilde was also wondering why this person, how this person is able to maintain such kind of emotional indifference. So when the night before the execution, other people, I mean, they paid all their ears to the sound of digging graveyard for that person. But this person, he was not that bothered about that sound. Had a sound sleep. And the next day, while he was executed, and other prisoners are unlocked from their cell. So has to see the particular person lying on the ground. They were terrified. They were frightened by that sight. But I mean, jail authorities, they mocked and disrespect the corpse. I mean, the dead body of the man. So, yeah, Oscar Wilde wishes that finally that man will be able to sleep peacefully. He'll be able to join his wife. And the fifth part of the poem. Yeah. So fifth part of the poem is a kind of what? Acceptance. See, if you commit some mistake in your life, obviously you will have to repay it. At some point in life, you will have to repay what you have done. Similarly, when other people fail to understand that great truth of a person who was executed, that is Charles Thomas Woolrich, he accepted that great truth. That is why he was able to maintain that indifference all throughout his period in that jail. Okay. Now, part six. So, part six is a kind of what? Restating the entire poem. Poet is restating. Yes. So, here, the sixth part and the final part, also, shortest part is summary of the poem. Just like an essay, we restate the points that we have discussed in the middle and in the beginning. So here he once again discusses the disrespect shown by the jail authorities and the indifference of towards death. And the final moment of that particular person. And once again, he uses repetition. And all men kill the thing they love, and by all let this be heard. Some do it with a bitter look, and some with a flattering word. Coward does it with a kiss, the brave man with a sword. I mean, coward people, cowards, they will die many times, but brave man will die only once. So actually, he had made Charles Thomas Woolrich a hero. Because, I mean, a person who is constantly afraid of something, he is dying every moment, isn't it? Every moment he is dying. If you are constantly under a threat, if you are under a threat, you are not living. You are dying every second. That means you are a coward. So coward will die many times, but a brave man will die only once. So Thomas Woolrich, who was not at all bothered about his execution or his life in jail, or even though he was disrespected and mocked by the corpse, he was celebrating his remaining days. Actually, he has been portrayed as a hero, while other prisoners who are very concerned about this person, they are cowards, because they are under the threat, because some of them believe that the same plight will come to them. So yeah, first people are cowards. Now, so there are many poems in block 8, and apart all these poems are long poems. So anyway, I have included all major points in these slides. Please go through it. So next class, we can discuss about block 9, T.S. Eliot's poem, Wasteland, and William Butler's poem. So what 6 poems are there in 6 plus 1? Yes, 1 long poem and 6 short poems in block 9. Okay. Let me tell you one more thing. See, in all these slides or the PDF I have shared on WhatsApp group, I have included almost all points which you can use for essay writing and annotation. So when you read your textbook, you may also go through the PDF I have shared.
ओके मैम,
Okay, see you next week.
ओके मैम, थैंक यू, थैंक
थैंक यू मैम,
यू मैम,
ओके मैम, थैंक यू.
ओके.